Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and thank you for coming to the Masonic Temple. I'm proud to introduce, from Honduras, Dr. Savior. Dr. Savior is a world-renowned healer, and he's come here today to give us his greatest gift. One more round of applause.
Ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, the nigga is here. Is because of you.
Thank you!
You see, you made me. And you didn't even know it. You made me. I want to thank you for taking time out of your busy schedule to come and listen to your brother. Because I want you to know that your presence today let me know that I am supposed to behave accordingly. Because you're showing me your love and your respect for the entity, to our ancestors. I love you. I came to America in 1954. I stepped off of the banana boat with a pair of tennis, white pants, white shirt. Never been to school. The boy was 20, 21. You helped me to be what I am. Now, how are we going to connect the dots with the continent from which we were severed? How are we going to connect the dots? We have to. Because never in the history of the black race has we been sick as we are now. In and out of Africa, we are sick. We are so sick that we can't even find a reason why we should come together. And you know something? It's in place. It's right in place. Because you do not feed the food of a gorilla to a polar bear and vice versa. If you feed the food of a polar bear to a gorilla, he too would be confused like we are. Because he wasn't designed for that food. His cellular predisposition is not designed to eat meat. Who told us to eat meat? Who did that? The continent of Africa didn't have any cows, and they didn't have any lamb. They didn't have any goats, chicken, or hogs. They didn't have any rice and beans and potatoes and yams and wheat. What did they eat? The anthropologists, the archaeologists, the paleontologists, and the scholars, they did not write about that. They write about wisdom. Well, I never knew what that was, and I'm 81 years of age. They talk about knowledge. I still don't know what that is. But you know what they didn't write in their manuals and their books? What you was, what we, not you, we, were supposed to put in our mouth. They never wrote about that. Why? They didn't write about it because they too were suffering with the same disease that we all are suffering with. The mucus that I told the Supreme Court that represents the one disease is affecting our brain. It's affecting our brain so much so that when I went to the continent the first time many years ago, they asked me for a passport. And I asked the man at the immigration entrance, why do you want to ask me for a passport when this is the continent from which I was suffering? I need a passport to come back home. Could you imagine how sick we are? You see, we need healing. I need healing. So now let's go back into the pages of history. What the anthropologists and the historians write about, what the scholars dismiss. Whenever nature creates something, that something has to follow a rule, a law. You will not find penguins in the desert. You will not find polar bears in the desert. He could only live in the cold. But you would never find a gorilla in the snow. That is not his home. He has to obey that law, that cosmic arrangement. It is like the little frog in Puerto Rico. Cookie? Cookie? Cookie, that frog sing you to sleep. But if you remove that frog from Puerto Rico, 9 kilometers away to Vieques, the frog dies because you have interfered. You have interfered with the cosmic arrangement of that frog. The frog was not placed in Vieques. Black people were not placed in America. We were placed in Africa. But with that African placement, there was a mandate. Yeah, there was a mandate. Black people, well, let me begin the process of showing what Mama was about. I happened to be in Brazil 7 years ago. And there was a conversation with a Mexican and a Frenchman. The Mexican was telling the Frenchman, you shut your mouth. We Mexicans make tequila. You Frenchmen don't make no tequila. We are the man. And the Frenchman started laughing and said, you forgot who made champagne. So all of us started laughing because we know that the Frenchman won the argument. So the Mexican said, and what about you, Sadie? What do you have to say about your people? Well, I have a little bit. So the Russian, not in all, said, you better watch what you say about your people. I said, why not in all? Because your mama didn't have no clothes on 500 years ago. My mama didn't have no clothes on. I looked Raul, the Mexican, I said, Raul, did you have a night off, sir? He said, yeah, that your mama didn't have any clothes on 500 years ago. And the Frenchman said, why don't you defend her? I have to defend my mama. He just did. But he didn't know it. You see, it's a matter of interpretation. The Frenchman, the Russian said, my mama didn't have any clothes on. He had no idea what he was doing. I said, Radunov, why did you, of all the items that mama didn't have, you stopped at her clothes? But as for her clothes, you mean to tell me that my mama didn't have no clothes on and walked the jungles of Africa for millions of years among her brothers and sisters and friends, nobody was jumping on her? I said, right enough, you just messed up. You were showing us that mama lived in a highly ethical society, a highly moral, that she could walk around without no clothes, and nobody was jumping on her. What kind of folks were living then? And if you want to know where the brain were, you take your clothes off during the summer and you walk the streets of Brooklyn and see what's going to happen to you. We begin to see that the contradiction that we have accepted is to be the very thing that caused our demise. Mama, the most powerful of all the genders or the gender. Mama, to tell you and I that the lion is the king of the jungle? Oh yeah. Who teach him what he knows? Who teach the lion what he knows? His mama, isn't it? Because you never saw a cub in the forest following daddy. Never would you find a cub following daddy. He followed mama because she and she alone have the secret of life, how to raise a child, not a daddy. I am a daddy many, many, many times. I never tell my children anything about one now. Since I is here, my 34 years old son, I haven't seen him in some time. I never beat Sisa. I never tell Sisa anything. So now, we come back to Mama. Mladenov said she didn't have any clothes on. She didn't have any clothes. She didn't have any doctors. She didn't have any medicine. She didn't have any hospital. But she didn't have any disease. You know why I know that Mama didn't have any disease? It's simple. It's very simple. That's why I know that she should not have been looked at and categorized as a savage. Because she lived in an alkaline world. And it is alkalinity that brings about tranquility. Mama. Mama didn't need a hospital. She lived in an alkaline world. And it is Mama that prepared me for this journey. How? How does she connect the dots? Very simple. Mama didn't have any money, she didn't have any alcohol, she didn't have any prostitution, she didn't have anything that we have today in the civilized world. Mama lived connected to the laws of life. She couldn't make any mistakes because she didn't read any books. I have not read any books. My son is 34 years of age. He didn't see daddy read any book, save the books on herbology. And I read those to find that there were loaded with inconsistencies, all of them. Every book that has been written on herbology is a lie. If they were true, you wouldn't be here today. You were here because you heard the doctor say you cured the diseases that hasn't been cured. Of course, I set out to do that for you. I'm doing it for you, and doing it for me. I was a steam engineer making a lot of money, but I wasn't satisfied because a Mexican had healed me. And I know that healing could be a thing, that we could receive healing, that healing was true. But all the herbalists in America was reading these books proclaimed out of Europe, and they were giving you golden seal, and they were giving you peppermint, and they were giving you echinacea, and they were giving you golden seal, and not to mention aloe vera, and noni, and moringa, to give you all that. You know why they did that to you? Because you had both eyes closed, and they had one eye open. But that is taking advantage of an individual. You don't do that. You respect your family. Yes, you do. You respect your family. So the only reason why you may have offered them these poisons, either of ignorance or I just don't care. Well, no, we're not going to do that. The time has come that the elasticity is about to pop. Look at Africa. Africa is loaded with disease. Ebola is not the disease of Africa. The disease of Africa is what? Malnutrition. They're suffering with a deficiency that all of us are suffering with. You understand? Let me break it down. Whenever I need to strengthen your bones, I go to a plant known as sea moss. Why? Because the active ingredient is calcium. When I want to nourish the blood, I go to the burdock, I go to the sarsaparilla, or I go to the other one, which is known as encino. Because their active ingredient is iron. Whenever you talk about birds, what do birds eat? Seeds and fruits. Please don't tell that to an eagle. He eats meat. He will eat meat. He will eat you. But he's a bird. But if you leave that bird and go to another bird, like the love bird and the quetzal from Guatemala, they eat seeds and fruits. Everything has a food designed for them. What is our food? Please don't look for it. Because our school teachers, our anthropologists, and our historians didn't write about that. So don't even look for it. And if we are not eating the food that is consistent with our cellular predisposition or our DNA, we are crazy. We are out of our mind, and I'm one of them. I'm one of you. You think I wasn't born sick? I was born with asthma. I was born with bronchitis. A baby is born sick. Yes, a baby is born sick. Mama, what did you eat with daddy before you went to bed that night to make me? Well, one day we eat crabs, the other day we eat lobster, the other day we eat conchs, the other day we eat shrimp, the other day we eat hog, the other we eat chicken and cow. And it's repeated in the cycle. The sperm that was injected into my mama 81 years ago that is responsible for me today, you think that it was of the quality of my father in Africa 600 years ago? that it was not impregnated with blood or starch, which is acid? Come on now, you know we're sick. We are sick, but we cannot criticize ourselves because nobody is out of it. I'm in it with you, just as sick as you. I may be even sicker, but to rectify that disease state is what we have for today. Not to criticize anyone. We are here to change it, to rectify it, and to bring back the love that existed long time ago with us. Because we are still in love, but it has been umbrellaed or tempered with what? With rice and beans, hot mars and chitlins. Yeah. And I was telling my son just now how I appreciate him, because for many years, since I used to hate to see me sneak and eat fish, I used to always catch me with it. And he didn't like that. Well, Daddy left that long time ago. But I still get the urge to want it though, because that is the degree of the conditioning that we've been placed in. So, I used cocaine once. I was going to Peru where I bought cocaine for $100 an ounce. I left that really quick, but it took me a long time before I left that rice and beans. Isn't that something? So now, brothers and sisters, Dr. Sabi, your brother, that came to New York, and you supported him. All of you supported Dr. Sabi. And I appreciate that, because when I was arrested because I put the ad in the newspaper that I cure AIDS, sickle cell, lupus, herpes, blindness, cancer, and others. Hey! Hey look, I'm like you. I'm representing you, whether I like it or not. And I wasn't gonna misrepresent you. Under no circumstances. In 1979, 1978, I met a young man in Los Angeles, Kweku Wando, the ethnobotanist. I said, what are you studying? Chinese medicine. I said, you look Chinese. He died. I met another black man in Chicago, Dr. Sidney. What are you studying? I'm studying homeopathy. You look like a British. That's Hahnemann. He died. I saw Dr. Kite. Who was responsible for me getting the place in New York? Dr. Kite was that kind. I asked him, what are you studying? He said, the Ayurveda. But the Ayurveda offers cream of cow milk. It offers curry, which is part of ours. That's bad. Don't you know that one-third of world dialysis are Indian, Dr. Kite? Man, what kind of nonsense are you talking about, Sabi? I say, it is nonsense. One-third of the world dialysis patients are Indian because they eat curry. And curry is made up of polymers. What are polymers? Turmeric, paprika, and cumin. There aren't any plants that produces cumin and turmeric and paprika. They're laboratory products. They're gonna hurt you. They're gonna injure you. But the Indian doesn't know that. And Dr. Kite had no idea. He wound up in the dialysis machine and died. What do I represent? The African bio-mineral balance. When Dr. Sabi came to New York and he saw it fit to put the ad in the paper with the recommendation and the advice of my mother said, boy, I'm going to tell you something right now. I remember you're my first son. And I wanted you to be a preacher. And you told me, What did you ask me, Mama? I said, I want you to be a preacher, Fred. And you said, I'm going to be a preacher. Mama, I want to be something better than that. And I meant that. Why did I say that? Because that's me. That's my DNA. That's my thumbprint. I'm different than you in my behavior. I'm just like you in my DNA. So in the attorney general now is confused. Why this man doesn't want to remove this ad? Well, I'm not gonna remove it. They came and took me to jail. My mama and I were the happiest people on earth. But everybody that was working with me was crying, some of them. Marjorie was crying. And a lot of them was feeling bad. And when they put the cuffs on me and put me downstairs to put me in the car to take me to the precinct right here off of Flatbush, Channel 7 said, Dr. Sebi, do you really cure AIDS? I cure AIDS then, I cure AIDS now, and for as long as I live, I cure AIDS. Well, how do you feel to be arrested? I said, I feel good. Because the police have to do things the police way. Every step of my arrest was dramatic. When they took me to the prison, the man who was going to put the number on my chest, he looked at me and said to the detective, you guys messed up. The detective said, why? Because this man really healed. I said, how do you know? You healed me of gout. That's how I know. I said, but sir, I have never seen you in my life. He said, no. Because I sent a black policeman to tell you that he had gout. And he brought me the medicine. I was cured. I said, why didn't you come? Why? Because I heard one of your speeches, man, and I don't know if you love white people. I said, sir, let me tell you something. There isn't a black man anywhere in the world that hates you. We fight wars for you. We die for you. You know why? That's us. We could only uphold love, but we thought that was the meaning. I said, sir, where did you get this stuff from that we hate you, that you were scared to come to me? Well, man, I didn't know. I said, I know that. He said, thank you, man. Thank you very much. Of course. I never forget what Elijah Muhammad teach me. Who is the original man? You know what's behind that. The maker, the owner, the cream of the planet Earth, and the God of the universe. Well, we're going to live up to that. Because that was our position all through life. When I passed through Peru recently, a Peruvian said to me, do you know what you represent? I said, man, I represent so many things, I may not know what you're talking about. He said, well, are you a part of the organic family? The organic family? I said, yeah. The organic family. I said, who are they? The black man, the Inca, the Maya, the Toltec, the Olmec, the American Indian. I said, what made them the organic family? They didn't have any toilets. I said, that must have been pretty funky, isn't it? He said, not so. Because we only ate organic food, that which was alkali. So therefore, we could pass it with fecal matter in our hand, and it didn't have any stench to it, and we put it back in the soil. But we didn't eat in the toilet. And we didn't have any waste. Because everything was biodegradable. We didn't know that. You see, we are a member of the organic family.
So, as the case progressed against me, I'm in court now, and that, wait, oh, I've got to bring this part out. Judge William Schotter, the black man from Washington, D.C., that many of you told me that I should change the venue to another court because the man was an Uncle Tom. I said, you know, man, I don't use those words to identify my brothers. I don't know who is an Uncle Tom, and I don't know what is an Uncle Tom. But this judge, Charter, the black man that they said was an Uncle Tom, look what he's gonna do. They're litigating me down there because, you know, in the civil case, he's judge and jury. They're litigating me down there. The attorney general assistant to the state is asking Dr. Victor Herbert, Dr. Victor Herbert, have you ever heard of any therapy that curates? He said, no. Have you ever heard of any individual that curates? He said, no. All this time, the judge got his eyes closed, cleaning his fingernails. I see this judge is careless. Then the attorney general assistant asked, have you heard of any compound that cures AIDS? He said, no. And the judge opened his eyes and he said, what's that mean?
Whoever's double parked, you guys are about to get told.
A silver Honda that's double parked outside. You need to move your car, somebody needs to get out. Or they're going to tow your car. So if you park a double park in front of the building, please move. Thank you.
Have you ever heard of any compound that cures?
This black man, when he heard Dr. Victor Herbert, said, no. The judge asked the doctor, have you opened Exhibit A, Dr. Savy's compound? He said, no. The judge said, thank you.
When the doctor saw that the judge just destroyed his premise, the doctor said, Your Honor, I know all about herbs. If I hit my monitor, I'll get 8,000 herbs in the monitor. He said, the judge said, so. He said, well, take me to the box club. The judge said, the white or the pink. I said, oh my God. This black man knows all about herbs. He's a judge. At the ending of the case, the judge said, Dr. Savy, when you walk in my courthouse, the court wanted me to see you as a villain, but I saw an honorable man. Today, we both won. When I was 18 years of age, I said that I want to do something that makes a difference. I didn't do anything but to become a judge. But today, you gave me the privilege to judge that which makes the difference. So we both won today, and you helped me. You said now, you gotta go across town to the criminal side. That's in Brooklyn on Adams Street, Supreme Court. I got there, judge and jury, the press and everybody. And I'm the boy that didn't go to school. I never been to school. You see, my grandfather told my grandmother, don't send this nigga to school. Let him stay home.
I like his brain. And I was happy little boy. By the river every day. Naked all the time. I was naked until I was 11. I was bare feet. I didn't wear no shoes. In fact, my grandma didn't have any money to buy no shoes. And I didn't even care. So that's why I know that a child doesn't know what poverty is. Because poverty is unreal. So the Attorney General now, I'm in court, and they got all these people, and I am the one now, the uneducated brother. Of course I am. I even find pride in knowing that I am uneducated. Why is that? Gorilla doesn't go to polar bear to get no degree. Gorillas. Trained gorillas. I have to go to a white boy to get a PhD. Oh my God. The judge walk in. You gotta put your hand in the Bible and swear to tell the truth, not for the truth to help you God. I said, no. I'm not gonna put my hand on the Bible because many have placed their hand in the Bible and have perjured themselves. The Bible doesn't guarantee truth. I guarantee truth, not that Bible. The judge said, let him sit. The case began. What is your argument? I say, I have three questions. Three questions? I say, yeah. You know, I make things simple. You see, I'm the boy that didn't go to school. I follow my own rule. Not the rule of the philosophers. What comes into my brain, I put that into execution. I say, Ron, I have three questions. What are they? You know anything you say will be held against you? I say, that's been all my life. What are the questions? Well, is it a fact that the Bible showed that the herbs are for the healing of the nations? She said, yes. Herbs? She said, yes. Herbs are for healing? She said, yes. Is it a fact that the father of medicine, Mr. Hippocrates, established the principle of medical science by curing all disease? Did he use chemicals or herbs? The judge said, herbs again. Last question, Your Honor. Is it a fact that science shows that the human body is carbon-based? And because the human body is carbon-based, the substance that is to complement that carbon-based body has to be carbon-based? She said, yes. I said, because when a substance is carbon-based, there is electricity. And you, my brothers and sisters, are electrical. Electric plant, electric body. That you call is chemical affinity, compatibility, and there is assimilation. Wow, the judge said, what school did you go to? I said, Your Honor, I've never been to school. You never been to school? And where did you get this information? I said, the same place the eagle got her information from when she makes her nest. The same way the beaver got his information when he made that dam to catch that fish. Do you need to go to school to use common sense? Does the school teach us common sense? No. The school teaches philosophy. And that's what we get in medicine today. So, Your Honor, if Mr. Hippocrates, the father of medicine, used herbs to cure diseases, when did it change? They didn't know, but I knew. It changed with a Dutchman in Holland, 1729. Bombastus von Homenheim, better known as Paracelsus. Why did he change it? Because he found that Hippocrates had gone to Africa and found some black folks hanging on trees and swinging and running here and there. I never got him sick. And when he noticed, it was the leaves that they were eating that kept them alive and strong. Oh my God, he went back and wrote, your medicine should be your food, or your food should be your medicine. And incidentally, when I went to Africa, I found one that told me, when I asked him, I said, what is the food of the black man? He said, nothing. Oxygen. Well, today is my 62nd day of not eating. And why my body doesn't give me the signal of hunger? I am not supposed to be in front of you talking on a 62-day fast. You know why I came? I came because of you. We have set the date to come today, and I knew that my body was not in total shape to come to see you, but I had to do it. This young man here brought this chair because I said I was in Philadelphia, and in the middle of my speech, I fell out. I had to fall out. I was using a lot of energy, and I'm fasting for 2 months. That was okay. I know I will return. And I put in this speech, and everybody loved him, and so did I. So today, I want you to know that a black man could go many months and years without eating. And as for right now, we need to change our diet quick. Because the love that we need to muster, to share among ourselves, would not surface until we remove vestiges of blood and salt from our body. We beat our children, we hate the neighbor hates you. And I live that. I never hate my children though, but I used to hate my neighbor. I even hated my wife, I want to kill her. I want to kill Marilyn. I really did. You know, insanity is dangerous. Because while you are indulging in it, you are totally unaware. Now, let us stop that. Let us see what is it that we, the black race, has to offer the world as an entity of healing, as a method. We have the African biomineral balance. The judge said, the Dr. Victor Herbert said, when the judge asked me, Dr. Sandy, why do you give everybody the same compounds, the same compounds or remedies. I said, because there's only one disease. One disease? Dr. Victor Herbert jumped up and said, this man is insane. He's unscientific. And the man didn't know what he was doing. I said, Your Honor, if I am unscientific, as Dr. Victor Herbert said, he is 100% right. But if science has to be the barometer or the yardstick that we're going to use to reverse disease, science already has 500 years. They have not cured one. So it behooves us to look outside of science. And what do you have outside of science, Dr. Sebi? You have the African biomineral balance. Victor Herbert jumped up and said, I've never heard of such a thing. Your Honor, Dr. Victor Herbert is right again. He has never heard of the African biomineral balance. But we have to remind the good physician that he has not heard of a whole lot of other things, and that the African biomineral balance only happened to be one of those things. What is the African biomineral balance? Wow. Remember the doctors before me. They were studying Ayurvedic, homeopathy, and the other one, which was Chinese medicine. But I'm not a Chinaman. I'm not an Indian. I'm not a European. I'm out of the jungle. And if you bring me something that doesn't belong in the jungle, you are offending me. You don't like me. Because what you bring to me isn't consistent with me. You see, we have to reconnect. We have to reconnect to those substances that kept our mothers and fathers healthy in the jungle. I went to Africa and I found many, many herbs that does just that. So we have to reconnect. Dr. Victor Herbert doesn't know anything like that. And the doctors of today will tell you that if they take your blood and the blood of a Chinese, the blood of a white man or an Indian, they could tell the difference. There's a difference. Not that we are better. There is a difference. But has the difference been treated? They give you the same thing they give everybody else and every genetic group. That is inconsistency. You don't do that. So, the FDA didn't want me to distribute my products. And I could understand that. Because I understand the devil. Of course I do, I understand everything. I even love the devil. Why? Because that's all I have to offer, love. And they tell me that everything God made is good, but God made the devil too. You see, I make it easy. You see, I learned in Christianity many beautiful things. Islam, I shared some of the most beautiful moments of my life in Islam. I met Messenger Elijah Muhammad. I met Malcolm many times. I met Brother Akarim Allah and Brother Willard and Brother Sharif. I met Brother Raymond Sharif, Brother John Ali, National Secretary. I met the Messenger. I ate with the Messenger. And the one thing the Messenger said that stayed with me now, today, and always will, you do not curse a dirty glass on the table. You put a clean one beside it. Am I right? And you know another thing the Messenger said? We someday have to stop eating meat. And the year that I was with the Messenger was 1959. I was with the Messenger in Chicago, 38, 37, South Woodlawn Avenue, where he lived. So, as I look at my life, I'm a product of Christianity, Islam, and Buddha. And do I love all of them? Of course I do. Because they all treat me well, and they all showed me good things. But I had to go to that naked woman in the jungles of Africa. Why? Because she connected the dots. He was the one that showed me that in order for us to heal, we have to use alkali substance. We cannot use any acids. Right in Washington, D.C., there is to occur two things that I must share with you that is important. Your brother Sebi, the uneducated boy, had to go through some of the most challenging moments with the physician. Washington, D.C., Achilles trauma, sickle cell anemia. The doctors cannot cure sickle cell. Oh, they can. They can't cure anything because the methodology is off the mark. So, Achilles trauma has sickle cell. She's two. Her daddy came and snatched her to the hospital against the doctor's will and knowledge, took her to Silver Spring. I began to treat her. 3 months passed. Achilles is well. She doesn't have the upper pulmonary disorder, which is the company of sickle cell, which is thalassemia. Am I right? The little girl is playing. She's happy. Why? She's lacking of iron. We all are lacking of iron, including me. So they caught up with us and took the parents to to the hospital with the police and took me in a police car from 2010 Kendall Street Northeast in D.C. to the hospital.
Well, me, I'm a regular looking man all the time. I dress like this all the time. I'm
just funky. And I had these funky shoes on. And I had these burger stuffs on of my bare feet. And in walks in the superintendent of the hospital, Dr. Steinberg. This is showdown time. The boy from the jungle against philosophy.
Who is this man?
That's me. This that Dr. Sebi. What kind of doctor are you? I said, well, I don't know what kind of man. I didn't know we came in kinds. You know, I help people when they need help. I don't know how to be a kind of. But before we get into this very tasteful dialogue, I want to submit to you the law that I kept for 90 days that I gave it to the girl, her diet, and what I gave her as a substance to reverse sickle cell anemia. She goes through it. Boom, 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 boom. Oh, you did not give a killer any protein. Oh my God.
This man didn't give a child any protein.
I said, I don't even know what is protein. Because I don't know. I'm 81 years old. I've never found protein.
Unless the great doctor said we think that protein is a necessary food.
I said, I didn't say that. You say that. But as for protein, is it electrical? Why do you ask that? I said, because the human body is made up of 102 minerals and they all are electrical. The body doesn't assimilate anything unless it is electrical. Nothing unless it is electrical. That is how the body assimilates things. Is protein electrical? And if it is electrical, Dr. Steinberg, it has to have a certain amount of electrons per atom.
Well, I don't know that. Protein is one of the 19 amino acids, the building block of life.
I said, I'm really confused. Amino acids. The human body is not made up of amino acids, nor any alphabetical letter like vitamin A that they found in carrots. The body is made up of minerals. So where do we accommodate amino acids in the human body? How do we do that, Dr. Steinberg? Dr. Steinberg, I'm confused. You're leading me in a path that it was virtually unknown to me. Amino acids, are they electrical? I want you to identify protein. Nobody can. You can, I can, and nobody can. It's a made up word. Has no place in the human body. And the policy is, you find the highest concentration of protein in pork meat. Yeah. And when someone is suffering with Alzheimer's, he has an extra protein in his blood. Damn it, will protein no longer become equitable? It's something else now, isn't it? Yes. I'll say that to Tanner, but that's your question. What is sickle cell anemia? Well, sickle cell anemia is a disease that black people got 10,000 years ago because their blood went through mutation. I said, oh God. Oh, I said, I'm really delirious now. Because we have a brother named Gregory. that sat in Crandon Hall, that sickle cell was given to us by God to fight malaria. You now said it's mutation. The problem with both statements is that they both came from Europe, because the Gregor was not trained by an African perspective. He was trained by your brother. And your brother told you it's mutation. And your brother told the Gregor it's God. Well, let me tell you something, Dr. Sandberg. It's neither God nor mutation. It's the deprivation of iron chlorine. And I think that I'm sick and tired of this little moment, sitting here, being interrogated, and you have no premise or foundation. Let me get the hell out of here. And I left. You understand? That's a bit of arrogance in this Sagittarius. You don't play with me. I didn't come to be played with, and I don't play with anyone. Now, the second one is, I went to see a lady that was suffering with excruciating pain at Howard Hospital, and my mother had told me that whenever a woman have a baby and she suffers with excruciating headache because of a piece of the placenta, or what we call the afterbirth, is in the uterus still, and it needs to come out. Well, I learned that from a little boy with my parents, because it was my mother and my grandmother that raised me, not a father. So I took my little bottle of arnica to the hospital, and the doctor said, "You're gonna give her that over my dead body." And the ambassador of Nigeria said, "I'll arrange that too." I pushed him out the way and I ran in. I gave the woman the compound. She no longer had the headache in less than 5 minutes. She expelled something very ugly. On the way out, the bulletin board read, "Sickle cell meeting on Georgia Avenue, May 18, 1983. The people that are with me said, "You got to go to that meeting." I said, "Are you crazy? Are you out of your mind? I am not going to be able to talk. I am not part of the elite. I'm the boy that doesn't belong to any organization. I'm the boy that doesn't have anyone to defend him and help him. Why should they give me audience?" One of the women said, "You got to go anyway." So I went. I went in with my Birkenstock and my white pants and shirt, and all the doctors on Georgia Avenue and the Sickle Cell Research Foundation building that you may know. I walk up there, I felt strange because all these doctors, they went to school for many, many, many years. They think they didn't go to anything. I sit there and wait, because there's a Frenchman from Abidjan who is coming to give us a talk on sickle cell anemia. Dr. Pierre Landerdorf is the great hematologist in Abidjan. Listen to what this man is going to say. Listen carefully now. I want you all to pay attention, because I didn't come here to confuse you. I came here to share information with you that was shared with me and that I have gathered over the years, not to come with some lies to you. You are my family. And if I have to dig you in the grave, then I'm not doing anything too beautiful, isn't it? We have to be ethical. We have to be moral. We have to have some principle. Here walking Dr. Pierre Landerdorf. "Good evening." I stood up. "Good evening. Everybody sit down. I am Pierre Landerdorf, and I am the leading hematologist at the University in Abidjan. And I have been treating a sickle cell patient for 14 years, AS group. And what is significant in this patient is that every time he's under stress, lactocomia shows up in his blood. Under certain stress condition, lactocomia shows up. I said, he just did the first mistake. I didn't say anything because these doctors went to medical school. I didn't go to any school. They should hear what this man is saying, but they're not listening. I have been treating this patient for 14 years. And lactocomia is always present under certain stress condition. And they begin to give this man a standing ovation. Oh my God, what am I going to do? I stood up. I said, Dr. Landedorf, I am a little bit confused. And it could be because of my ignorance that I am confused. Not because you are not intelligent. It could be my ignorance. But since you are the doctor and you are the intelligent one, I expect for you to help me. Did you say that your patient showed lactocomia under certain stress conditions? He said, yes. Do you disagree? Not at all. Not at all. But Dr. Landedahl, isn't lactocomia a byproduct or a derivative of lactic acid? He said, yes. And lactic acid is a derivative, a byproduct of milk. He said, yes. Right then, he destroyed his whole premise. What are you giving a black man milk that has sickle cell anemia? You see? But these things are not registering with us. We want to believe that we cannot offer a position that is credible. And it could not come from a black man. Especially one like me. How could you believe me when I didn't go to school? When it is school that determines whether you are smart or you are dumb. Well, I must be dumb. But in my dumb state of being, I have pure agency, cassette and lupus and herpes and cancer and blindness. So what's going on? Am I really dumb? So I said to him, Dr. Landedahl, what is sickle cell anemia? This response was truthful. I don't know. I said, thank you. But the doctors at Harvard said at some point, you shut your mouth. I said, what did you guys say? For me to shut my mouth? This man, medical philosophy, been ruling for 500 years. I only spoke for 15 minutes. I got 400, 300 and so many days left. Landedahl, tell this man something for me. You see, that's us. You made me what I am. I came off the banana boat, you know, with a pair of tennis. But I heard all you talk about Plato and Socrates and Diogenes and John Stuart Mill and Spinoza. I didn't read any of those books because it didn't relate to Africa. I heard talk about Jethro Cross and Alma Hutchins and Christopher and Carl Pepper. These are urbanists. I'm not a European. I'm an African. So when I go back to Africa, guess what I found? I found the cure for the diseases. But this is something that shows up too, that really I didn't want to touch upon, is this. Egypt. Egypt. Everybody in the 70s, Egypt. Egypt. We go to Abu Simbel, we go to Karnak, we go to Giza. For what?
Egypt, man, is the cradle of civilization. I said, oh, yes. Well, how come it came and left? Showing us that change is the only thing that is constant. So you go to Egypt. Man, you said to man. I said, hold it, man, I'm going to the jungle. When I came back from the jungle, I gave Michael Jackson's son an herb, the son that you guys don't know about. His name is Mikey. He lives in Norway. He had an excruciating headache for 5 years. I gave him an herb named Sia. He took tumor out of his nose 20 minutes later. And those that went to Egypt to the desert, they came back with a souvenir. I came back with healing. The jungle is alkaline. There is nothing in the desert. We are not desert people. We are forest people. So brothers and sisters, look, we don't have any reason to be ashamed of ourselves. Mr. Haney Blue, the musician that I so love, and he loved me, he loved you, and he's a very beautiful musician. He's in the line with Pharaohs and Coltrane and all those others. Pharaoh said, you know, Sandy, I think one of the problems is shame. Shame, as we look back at our history, that our genesis is a naked woman in the jungles of Africa. But it is that woman that gave Dr. Sabin the cure for all the diseases. Because the rest of the books written on herbology and on healing, nobody has ever cured the diseases that Mama has cured. That I learned from Mama, you, the black woman, you, the black woman that I said in 1962, when there was a conversation at Tim Barbershop on Claiborne Avenue in New Orleans, Louisiana. There was a bunch of us in the barbershop getting ready to eat our basket of shrimps, and we had a big bowl of gumbo, and we had some draft beer. Oh boy, we get ready to feast. And don't forget the jambalaya. And I was in the group eating it too. And it was 1962, I wasn't here yet. The nigga was eating everything under the sun. So, but the brothers in New Orleans, I must say this. Do you know that as I think of New Orleans is the most beautiful city, the city that I think of giving me a love that I never received in any other city in the world, New Orleans, Louisiana. In the barbershop. Man, you talking about a black woman? That's Starfire. That's Miss Ann. I said, why do I want to take that position against a black woman? We came out of her vagina, she ain't that bad. We came out of her vagina. I said, do you know that my mama was the biggest whore in the world? The biggest prostitute? She's my mommy. Damn it, that's my mama. Why you want to talk about her like that? Knowing that we are all damaged by being severed from mama, and you gonna talk about the black woman like that? Well, I'm gonna give her a gift. And what you gonna give her? I don't know. I'm gonna give her a gift. And I didn't know what the gift was gonna be. I didn't know. But when that Mexican Alfredo Cortez healed me of my diseases, he asked me a question that is yet to be heard from the pages of the anthropologists and historians, not to mention the scholars that are black. The Mexican asked me, where are you from? I said, I'm from Honduras, I speak Spanish. He said, you what? Man, you're out of your mind. He said, black people don't come from Honduras.
Maya, Paya, Lenka. So where are you from? Oh, I caught myself. I'm from Africa. He said, no, we could talk. Because you're all an African, I'm going to give you something that is specifically made for you. A certain food that is free of starch and blood. Why these anthropologists that you have read off as historians didn't write that? And the brother here was born sick, and he took a Mexican to heal him, to prepare me to come to you to heal you. You see, it goes around the organic family. All right? So, we about to take a break. Just hold up. We about to take a break so we can finish it. All right? Many times, there are many of you who have been to the village of in Honduras looking for help. You come with skin cancer. Dr. Sebi, I only have a week to pay for. This is all skin cancer. That's pearl. How could you cure someone with skin cancer in a week? She had to stay there 2.5 months. Who paid me for that 2 months? Plus, nobody. And there were others that came that didn't have any money, but they were dying. I'm supposed to just kick them out. You can't do that. You cannot do that. She's part of the family. So what I decided to do, with the aid of my mother, to put Bolingo together. Bolingo is the Bolingo Health Family, in which you are going to donate money to buy that village. That we could say, we own something, not Dr. Sebi. So that when you get sick, you don't have to think about paying me $1,500 a week or $1,000 a week. That's really ugly. You have allowed me to charge you money. Now, we're going to buy the village. I'm selling it. When you join Bolingo, not only would you own the village, we're going to open healing centers in New York, Chicago, Atlanta. So just look out on the website of Dr. Sebi for the Bolingo Health Family Club. And after we have collected so much money, which we, our target is $200 million. Why $200 million? The place is only going to be sold to you for about $5 million. The rest will be in constructing these healing centers throughout the United States and in Africa. We're going to make connection with Africa to import herbs. We're going to process herbs. We all going to be a member of this healing journey. Because when you get sick, you don't have to think about money now. You are part of the family. You see now? Of course. Of course you see. Because it has substance. It is workable. So brothers and sisters, ladies and gentlemen, please, I beg you to join Bolingo, because I'm hurting to know that when my mother told me, I went to D.C. and I asked him to give me just a dollar. If every black man in D.C. would have given a dollar, they would have been owning the village now. But they didn't, because they thought that I was going to run away with their money. Well, I don't need money. I never needed money. So now, my mama said, since they think that you're going to run away with the money, build the village, then sell it to them. And
Those of you that have been there, you have noticed that the village is dirty. They cut me off.
Right, no, brother. No, he unplugged it by mistake. Yeah.
Thank you very much. Thank you very, very much for coming. Look for the website and joining Bolingo. Because we need you just as much as you need me. I need you more. But I don't want to own the village anymore. I want us to own it.
We're going to have them right there.
Because there are people that don't have any money. We black people don't have any money.
Three doors need to be closed.
So why would you let me on the belly? Why can't we own something collectively? Whether you're Muslim, whether you're Christian, whether you're Buddha, you are not right. Thank you. Thank you very much.